Eleanor Jean Austin, 82, of Sutherland, passed away into the Lord's hands on Thursday, August 4th, 2016, in the Sutherland Care Center. Jean was born in Scotts Bluff, Nebraska on July 12, 1934, daughter of Pete and Eva Markheim Hessler. She was raised in Scotts Bluff County. The mother of five sons, she devoted her life to raising her children. After working at the local cafe and Coldwater Fish Farms Incorporated in Lisco, Jean retired to Sutherland. She enjoyed knitting and crocheting, creating beautiful pieces treasured by her family and friends. Jean was an extraordinary woman, loved by those who had the pleasure of knowing her. She will be dearly missed by family and friends. Preceding her in death was her husband, Hobart Jack Austin, and her siblings, Reuben Hessler, Leroy Hessler, Darlene Johannes, and Dorothy Kaufman. Survivors include her sons, Rick and Wings of Colorado Springs, Colorado, Bob Youngs of Sutherland, Stephen Youngs of Scott, Keith and wife Jerry Youngs of Roscoe, and Kenny Youngs of Sutherland, one sister, Loretta Kenyon of Escondido, California, and sister-in-law, Elsie Hessler of Lodi, California, also nine grandchildren and 11 great-grandchildren. Let us pray. Father, we come to you at a very difficult time, a time when somebody we love has been gone, is lost to us now. But yet, Lord, we come at a time of rejoicing as well because of the hope of heaven. And we know, Lord, because of her faith in Christ, that she is with you in heaven. And that if we have faith in Christ, we too will see you and her again in the future. So yes, this is a difficult parting, but yet we know it's going to be a joyous reunion one day in the future. And we know that because of the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So, Lord, I pray now that this service would remind us of Jesus and the hope we have. I pray that this service would exalt the name of Jesus Christ. And I pray, Lord, that this service would help us to deal with our grief through the lens of the truth of the forgiveness of sins and the guarantee of heaven with you through the death of your Son, Jesus Christ. So, Lord, comfort this family and these friends now with the truth of what you have done for us, Christ. It's in His name that we pray. Amen. read this afternoon. All of them are very, very familiar. None of them will really surprise any of us. And it's always interesting why people choose these sections over and over again. For some reason, they offer comfort. Well, actually, there's a good reason they offer comfort, because they're truth. There's no comfort in fables, folks. There's no comfort in wish. Things that are written in Scripture are true. And that's why they give us real comfort at times like this. So I'd encourage us to consider that as we listen to these. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table in the presence of my life. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Talks about our resurrection body. It says, now we know that the earthly tent we live in is destroyed. We have a building from God in heaven, not built by human hands. Meanwhile, we groan, longing to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling, because when we are clothed, we will not be found naked. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. Now it is God who gave us for this purpose and has given us the Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. We live by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and we prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So we make it our goal to please Him, whether we're at home, in the body, or away from it. And then finally, the words of Jesus in John chapter 14. And every time I read this text, it just amazes me at what's going on here. This is the Last Supper. And these guys have been with Jesus for 3 years. He's poured His life into these men. And Jesus is at the crisis in His life and ministry. He's going to die, and He knows He's going to die on the cross. And He knows that one of these guys has already ratted him out to the authorities. Judas is gone. And the other 11 that are left, He knows that they will run for their very lives in a few short hours. The ones who claim they would fight to the death for Him would be the biggest chickens on the face of the earth. And even though He's going to be going through awful, awful torture, pain unspeakable about His meeting their needs. And these are the words He says to His disciples. Let not your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my house, room, Lord, I told you, I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to Him, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Thank you. time I would like to share a poem that was written by a niece, I believe, Terry Kaufman Becker, about her aunt Eleanor. And after I read the poem, Christy's going to come and share some thoughts about her grandma. What Aunt Eleanor learned me, 150 strokes. Aunt Elle and I were buddies. We shared so many views. So many times we'd relive the past and laugh at what we knew. Because we were left-handed, adjustments were our call. You'll never do anything right, you know, we'd hear all day long. I baked my very first cake with her. Her instructions I recall. Count 150 strokes out loud so that the cake won't fall. When the time was up, the cake was done. Her boys had quite a treat. Those 150 strokes paid off. The mission was complete. She was the best, there is no doubt. She championed tasks for fun. Look out, heaven, here she comes. Her work on earth is done. This time, Christy has some words to share about her grandma.
I just want to thank everyone for being here to honor Grandma Jean's memory. During her lifetime, Jean was a loving mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, aunt, sister, daughter, and wife. She was comfortable living in Nebraska. She enjoyed the open space and peacefulness that comes with living in the country, although I think we can all vouch for her fear of tornadoes and thunderstorms. Grandma was a modest person who didn't want or need a lot in life. She was happy knowing that her boys were okay and that her family was okay. She was happy with that little bit of traveling she'd done out to California, and I can't even imagine traveling with those five young boys. She enjoyed camping and being on the lake, even if she did complain about not being able to sleep. Grandma, that was your snoring. We kept on the water. Can't be awake all night. And she was creative, knitting and crocheting the most beautiful blankets and doilies, pieces that are forever cherished. And I still have the clown blanket she made for me. 100 little granny squares, and I know you boys were like, how is she ever going to get that together? She loved to laugh. There was never a time I went to visit Grandma that we didn't laugh. She could find the humor in any situation, and her laughter was infectious. People enjoyed being around her. She was also spiritual and intelligent, and I remember many nights talking with her for hours. You name it, we talked about it. We were going to solve the world's problems. Her mind was sharp even as her body was failing her. While going through her things, we found evidence of how thoughtful she was as she pondered her end of life. We remember Grandma and we honor her family legacy. Forgiveness and love unconditionally. Don't carry that with you. That which upsets you. We were taught that there is a hell, but we make that in ourselves, and we need to get rid of that here on earth, or we'll take that with us. Seek the light always here on earth in the afterlife. I don't know how to meditate. My mind is too busy to let everything go. Love is the bridge to happiness. Forgiveness frees the soul to move to a higher place and to have more room in your heart for a greater love. Although I will be cremated, I didn't quite understand it, but now I'm sure that it is right. It just gets rid of the body faster, which is good because we can move to the light more quickly. It's the bad things you have to learn to atone for. How do you forgive yourself? Knowing and understanding oneself. Prayer is essential. All things can happen through prayer and love. Then you will receive the strength to move on. Eleanor Jean Austin.
I'm certainly not going to add anything to that, as I did not know Jean. Certainly didn't know her as well as you people knew her. But as I've talked with the family and visited with them, I have a picture of the kind of woman she must have been. In 1948, Dale Carnegie wrote a book called How to Stop Worrying and Start Living. And in that book, he made a phrase that is very familiar to us now, famous. When life gives you lemons, make lemonade. When life gives you lemons, make lemonade. Now, he did not originate that phrase. We really don't know who originated it. It doesn't really matter. But he certainly made it famous. I believe that phrase describes Jean Austin. Certainly, life gave her lemons. But she didn't have a sour face, she didn't complain, she didn't moan. She actually made lemonade. When I was asking Keith when he called me up and said his mom had died, I said, what do you remember about your mom? He told me two things. He said his mother was a hard worker and the toughest lady he'd ever met. Hard worker, the toughest lady he'd ever met. Jean was married and had five sons to an abuser. After she got out of that relationship, she was a single mom to five boys. This was before Lyndon Johnson's Great Society and food stamps and welfare and things like this. And you didn't work, you didn't eat. Jean Austin worked. She worked hard. I've often said the hardest job in the world is being a single parent, especially a single mom. You've got nobody to pass the buck to. When the stress levels get too high, you can't say, here, you take over. When you can't deal with it anymore, you can't say, it's your turn. You got to suck it up, and you've got to deal with it. A single mom raised five boys. Keith tells me that all the aunts and uncles said that those five boys would end up in the penitentiary one day. They didn't. None of you ended up in the pen, did you? You think so? Pretty good, guys. You know why? Because your mom loved you. Advice for you guys. And because of that, those prophecies of Jesus were not true. Jean was a person that handled adversity very, very well. Keith tells me that for the last 8 or 9 years in the rest home, she's suffered with a lot of pain due to many physical maladies that she's had. But as Christy was just saying, whenever she would go visit with her, she was always laughing. You know, she could very easily have turned inward and felt sorry for herself, said, woe is me, and complained all the time, but she didn't. She laughed at life, she laughed at herself. She made people that around came to visit her, come around her, made them feel welcome, made them feel like things were okay. She listened. She listened. You know, people that listen to other people are thinking more of the other person than they are of themselves. That's a pretty tremendous deal, isn't it? To be able to focus on listening when you should be complaining, when you should be feeling sorry for yourself, when you should be telling everybody how tough your life is, but Jean didn't do that. Jean is an amazing woman. And I think you guys can be proud that you had the mom that you had. You can be proud of your grandma, your aunt, your great-grandma, your sister. She truly was a great woman. But the thing I think that is most commendable in her life was her humility. And by this I mean this. When Keith told me that his mom was dying, I said, does she know Jesus? The question I ask everybody when they tell me somebody's dying. He said, well, when I talk to her about it, she says she knows him. I said, well, Keith, she's okay then. She's going to heaven. You see, Jean Austin understood that she wasn't good enough to earn her way into heaven. So she humbled herself and trusted what Jesus Christ did for her on the cross. You see, by our definition, by our standards, Jean Austin deserves to go to heaven, doesn't she? I mean, you can't think of a person that was a better person than her. Oh, yeah, there's all kinds of good people out there. And by our standards, if anybody deserves heaven, she certainly would be one of the top on the list, wouldn't she? You see, the problem is nobody deserves heaven. Jesus himself said, you therefore must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. And in Romans we read that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So nobody's perfect. So nobody is good enough to earn eternal life. Folks, that's why God sent his Son into the world. Because he knew we couldn't earn it. That's why Jesus came to this earth. was because unless he came to the world and died in our place, there was no forgiveness of sins. And so Jesus Christ on the cross paid the penalty that our sins deserved. And when he was dying on that cross, he was suffering in our place, taking the punishment that our sins deserved. And when he died and was raised again 3 days later, he proved that the penalty of sin had no power over him, so that all who would trust in Jesus would be forgiven and would know that when they died, they would spend eternity in heaven with God. It takes a humble person to trust Jesus. It takes a humble person to admit that they're not good enough. No matter how good everybody else tells them they are, it doesn't matter. They're not good enough for God unless they have Jesus. But when you have Jesus, you're perfect. When you have Jesus, everything's forgiven. When you have Jesus, you have that new resurrection body. Jean talked about hell on earth, and she experienced it. But there's a hell after life too, folks. That's why Jesus came. If there's no place called hell, there's no reason to send a Savior. If there's no place called hell, there's no reason for Jesus to die. But Jesus died to rescue us from that place. Jean Austin is in heaven now with God because she was a humble lady and knew she needed to trust Christ as her own personal Savior and Lord. And I guarantee you that right now, more than anything else, Jean wants no person to leave here without trusting Christ as their Savior and Lord if they have not made that commitment. There are probably no books written about your mom, grandma, your aunt, your sister, great-grandma. Probably be no great stories told in history about her. But near as I can tell, Jean Austin was a truly great human being. And you folks are privileged to have known her. And I would encourage you to cherish the memories of her and to let her life be a challenge to you to live life the way she lived life. But even though she was given a lot of lemons, Jean Austin made lemonade. And folks, she's in heaven with Jesus. And we can all know that we'll see her again if we'll trust Jesus Christ as our own personal Savior and Lord. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for the hope of heaven. I thank you, Lord, that you are your Son. Give of yourself so that we could have eternal life. Father, I thank you for Jean Austin and her life. She's a person that gave of herself for the benefit of others. That she needed a Savior. Oh, Father, I pray there's no person leaves this room today without trusting Christ as their Savior and Lord. I pray, Father, for the people here, especially for the family, that they would rejoice that Jean is with you in heaven. They would rejoice with the life that she lived, the example that she sets, the privileges that they had of knowing her, spending time with her, being raised by her, watching her set an example of making lemonade out of lemons. Lord, we thank you again for Jesus and your love demonstrated in him. And I just pray that the hope of the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead would carry this family through even as they grieve the loss of Jean. In your great name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Together out there immediately following this service. And now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit.